suo delegato di portarti i saluti e ovviamente il sostegno all'iniziativa che va nella direzione di spingere l'Ateneo verso livelli di eccellenza sempre più grandi. Il fatto di avere un premio di questo tipo, al di là del fatto che Stanef per noi era più che un amico, parlo adesso da fisico, va proprio nella direzione di allargare l'orizzonte del premio a livello nazionale e quindi di creare Tor Vergata come un elemento di riferimento per l'eccellenza nelle lauree magistrali in fisica teorica. Io credo che questo, dal punto di vista del rettore, sia molto chiaro e diciamo, il sostegno che è stato dato all'iniziativa tramite la Fondazione Raelin è un segno. Secondo me al rettore è anche abbastanza chiaro la necessità di stabilizzare questo premio, al di là dei 3 anni che più o meno sono coperti, quindi su questo bisognerà fare del lavoro, ma penso che ci siano delle buone possibilità. Se mi permettete, semplicemente a livello personale, a livello di membro del Dipartimento di Fisica, io ho interagito con Stanev dal punto di vista scientifico, dal punto di vista amministrativo, quando era rappresentante e coordinatore delle attività delle iniziative specifiche degli NFN, io ne ho una che si chiama PD51 ed è stata sempre una gioia poter interagire con lui perché credo che la disponibilità e l'umanità che lui aveva sempre nei confronti di tutti sia un insegnamento per tutti noi per portarne avanti il messaggio. Penso che questo premio debba avere una continuità e spero veramente che si riesca a. Grazie.
Passiamo la parola adesso al direttore, invece del direttore professor Lucio Cerripa, direttore del Dipartimento.
Buongiorno a tutti, io riporto i saluti del direttore del Dipartimento che proprio non ha potuto essere qui con noi. E nel darvi questo benvenuto, io vorrei ringraziare gli organizzatori per questa iniziativa, perché è un'iniziativa che in qualche modo ci ricorda quello che è la missione, uno degli aspetti del nostro Dipartimento, quello di fare formazione, di insegnare, e Yassin, come la maggior parte del personale dell'NFN, contribuiva alla didattica e alla formazione dei nostri studenti. E parte di questa formazione c'è la trasmissione delle conoscenze, ma al tempo stesso c'è la promozione, la valorizzazione della passione per la scienza. Questa, diciamo, l'esaltazione della passione che sta già negli studenti e che va in qualche modo nutrita, ecco, promossa. E quindi che cosa insomma, di meglio che non un premio che in qualche modo diciamo, prosegua questa valorizzazione della passione che c'è negli studenti per la scienza in ricordo di Assen. Quindi io ritengo veramente questa sia un'iniziativa diciamo, lodevole e appropriata e quindi ringrazio di nuovo gli organizzatori. Buon pomeriggio a tutti e adesso passo la parola al direttore di NFL.
Buon pomeriggio a tutti, anch'io come direttore della sezione INFN di Roma Tor Vergata vorrei ringraziare appunto in primis il nostro collega per aver veramente fortemente voluto questo evento in memoria di questo nostro collega che veramente così prematuramente scomparso lasciandoci in sezione un grande vuoto. Quindi sono felice che questa iniziativa sia stata seguita con il contributo di tutti, quindi ringrazio insomma tutti i partecipanti a questa iniziativa, spero che si possa ripetere e diciamo, volevo anch'io dire qualche parola in ricordo dal punto di vista scientifico, con cui spesso intrattenevo delle discussioni sul, diciamo, lo stato della fisica teorica, delle sue ricerche, di quello che io facevo da fisico sperimentale, ma soprattutto, diciamo, avevo delle discussioni anche su tematiche così, diciamo, importanti del nostro ente, le normative, le regole, gli statuti, la legislazione. E mi ricordo, diciamo, la ricchezza che lui portava, diciamo, nei consigli di sezione, perché era sempre lì a precisare esattamente, aveva una conoscenza approfondita del nostro ente, delle regole e diciamo, di tutto ciò che serviva a amministrare il nostro lavoro. Quindi per me è stato veramente un, come dire, un collega che mi ha, diciamo, dato tanto, quindi anche, diciamo, sotto il profilo di direttore di sezione, per cui veramente, diciamo, con molta commozione sono qui ad ascoltare questi interventi e a consegnare questo premio al nostro giovane ricercatore. Grazie.
So now we can switch to English and give the floor to Massimo Bianchi, chairman of the Scientific Association.
So, I'm very glad that I've been given this task to be the chairman of this scientific session. I've known Yassin for many years. I've collaborated with him on many projects, and we shared something because I have Bulgarian origins, and these made up more friends than others. And what I would like to say is that we are here, thanks to Yassin, and so we have to continue his legacy in scientific work. Thank you very much. The first speaker is going to be Augusto Sagnotti, Professor Sagnotti from SN Pisa. He will talk about Yassin Stanev, a valiant colleague and a dear friend.
Flavor of what Yassin was. And so the story starts when I met him. He came here in 1994, toward in the fall. And you know, we had this new postdoc paid by NFN, and you basically get to know the person. And it happened that I was working actually with Gianfranco at the time on a problem which was involving a computation which was rather involved. So we started to discuss and then sketched the problem, went into some details, and at some point the computation was there, said I will explain to you next time. And it was complicated, so I was, you know, expected that we would meet, and there was no need, because in a few days Yassin came back and he had his own little ordered notebook with all the computation from the beginning to the end, and all the days. So we started to collaborate very intensely, and scientifically, it was an extremely timely arrival, because what Yassin was an expert in conformal field theory. He had studied with Ivan Todorov, who was a long-time expert in the story, and conformal field theory is one of these subjects that recur at various levels in theoretical physics, and at that time his presence was really absolutely crucial. The problem was to collaborate with him, because I can do a computation quickly if I know the answer, more or less, so I can sketch it, but yes, I could do it quickly and correctly from beginning to the end. So at some point I found that the most efficient way to collaborate with Yassin was to let him go and guess the answer. And since I had some free time, it happened that sometimes I managed to guess the answer. And Yassin was an interesting character because he was somehow a peculiar person, very good-hearted, but he had a good temper. So that sometimes when I would guess the answer without doing the calculation, and he called me calculo at the time, because he was learning Italian, he would get upset. But upset in a very friendly manner. And then I discovered then very soon, because we became very close friends, that he had behind him his beloved wife Antonia, that could not be with us now because the son is actually taking an exam. That's Gianfranco didn't get to detect it. So he has an exam today, and basically they were both busy one way or another. So he had behind him the strength of his wife and some heavy artillery. And the heavy artillery of Yassen was maple. So he was really a master of maple to a level that I've not seen again. And maple, for those who know what I'm talking about, is a bit more professional in mathematics. You don't just sit down and use it. You need to play a little bit. And so basically, in 2 years of intense collaboration, we really became very affectionate. I used to call him the naughty one, il cattivo in Italian, because he was getting upset. And here is a nice recollection. Massimo must remember, they were working on a problem with Massimo, and they were in my office at that time. And so they were arguing about some result. He was not agreeing. And at some point he started really to burst into one of his occasional, bad tempers, and so I suggested that 3 cigarettes would bring him to the ground state. So he smiled, calmed down, and he went out and smoked one, which was already too much, as you know, in his case, but this was a small achievement in this sense. Now, another important thing is that it was not easy, because when Yassen came here, it became immediately obvious, at least to me, that Yassen was one person that should stay. He was not here for 2 years or postdoc. He should be a member of the group. And it was very difficult. There were 2 years or so after his postdoc ended, where it was clear that we should keep him. We wanted to keep him. And there was no clear way. We were using our research funds to pay him a few months here and there. And then the problem really was solved brilliantly by Giancarlo Rossi. Giancarlo had really the main role in this thing. He understood the value of Yassen before they started to collaborate very intensely in later years. And Giancarlo had some influence, he clearly convinced the relevant people that Yassen was a special case. And in a few years, he got this job in NFL. But it was difficult. If you allow me to digress slightly, I can give you some recollection that one of the difficult problems at that time was the time ordering between the application for the Italian visa and the reception of the visa itself. And they already applied for the visa, but it was a trivial story. I have 2 nephews in the police force, so the first time I got an advice from one of them where to go, and that was the Minister of the Interior, there was a huge line where many professions, if you allow me, were represented. Of various types, and scientists were the very sheer minority. So taking advantage of this peculiar experience, it happened at some point that Yassen needed to go to a conference, and if I remember correctly, it was after the summer, and this visa was not arriving, so I went to the police station in Frascati, and literally I told the people there, look, this guy is not smiling yet, but he's considering it very seriously, because he cannot do science. So the guy was shouting inside this police station, did not appreciate the joke, but eventually he got this this thing, maybe not for that, but we achieved something. Another thing about Yassen, after this is finished, is that Yassen was surprising, because I collaborated with him very intensely the first 3 years, and we only spoke in English with each other. So he used to say one Italian word and then, but I didn't have any idea that he knew Italian. So what happened at some point is that I left, I was away for 2 months, and then I came back, and I found a group of guests, and he was speaking Italian perfectly. And clearly, he must have been stimulated by my colleagues who let him practice differently from what I did. These are 2 last pictures that I will show you. Actually, I didn't comment too much on the other ones, so maybe I should. This is interesting. This is a picture taken in Amsterdam. Bert Skellegans, this is his wife, Bert Skenes was a collaborator of Yasser for some time.
I think this is in Bert's house in Amsterdam.
We were there. And this is a picture that is very dear to me because it was taken at what was our family house in Riera Matrice. You know that that area doesn't exist anymore, it's been flattened by the earthquake. And Yasser was a frequent visitor for us at the time. And this is Dennis, almost newborn. So let me finish with this story. The last one is interesting, it's a beautiful thing that we did together when I was here. Francesco Ruscito organized this conference in a beautiful location in Tuscany. Of course, we all know it all, but his idea was crucial. It was a whole village which was somehow used for this conference. We were living there for those days in several people homes in the Tuscan countryside. And these are other colleagues that were there. You can see again that Skenes, and this is Dmitry Vasiliev, the Russian colleague, and this is Ben Sundel, was also a frequent visitor. Finally, this is in this square. You cannot read the name, it was dedicated to my grandfather. It's the square in Amadish, you may have heard, where the school was. The school collapsed, the square doesn't exist anymore. Thank you very much. So this is the
we can call the next speaker, Professor Antonio Massiero, University of Padua, NIFM, and he will talk about outstanding questions at the frontier of particle and astroparticle physics. I'm the chairman, very good.
Yes, no, I was saying that I am pleased to give this talk today because I had the chance to meet and interact with Yasser and quite a number of times, in particular when he was coordinator of the activities here in Tor Vergata for the theoretical group of INFM, and I could appreciate, as Anna was remembering before, the precision and the wisdom of the interventions of Yasser every time in the theoretical committee of INFM. But the real reason why I am even more pleased to give this talk is the second aspect, which was also previously emphasized, namely the passion for physics of Yasser, but in particular his interest and enthusiasm into the young generation, the students and all say the young people who are approaching physics. I remember discussing some possible initiatives in this sense. So I am first of all very pleased that we are honoring his memory through this prize to this I think is the best way to remember also Jassen. And second, I am pleased also to speak of something that was our common interest about the challenges and the future of theoretical physics. Let me say that just in view of this interest on young people and students, I prepared this talk not for colleagues who are specialists in the field, rather in particular for the young people here, for the students. I'm sure that the Jassen would like this kind of approach. Okay, so. So let me start with a statement made by David Gross, a Nobel Prize winner, David Gross, about 10 years ago. And David was stating that we live in a very particular moment. Now, for the first time in human history, we have the possibility, the ambition, but also the concrete possibility to have an overall picture of the universe encompassing something like, you see, 60 orders of magnitude in length. So this is an extraordinary achievement of human being. There is no doubt. Now the question is in this might, namely, how close or how far, if you want, are we from really achieving a deep knowledge of the universe, going from the macrocosmos to the microcosmos. And this is a bit the challenge that I would like which I would like to illustrate here just a few aspects. Obviously, this is an enormous question, and it is an enormous challenge in front of us. So, there is no doubt that in these last 5 or 6 years we have accomplished a main milestone in this path to the impressive knowledge I was describing through the words of David Gross in the previous slide, namely, we have now two standard pictures, the standard picture of a macrocosmos and the standard picture of a macrocosmos. This thanks to the standard model of particle physics and the standard model of cosmology. Remarkably enough, both standard models can be, in a sense, summarized and we can have a kind of bird view of the two models just in one slide. So, thanks to the standard model of particle physics, we have a view now of what we consider really the elementary bricks constituting the matter of the universe and of the interactions acting upon these elementary particles of matter. On the other hand, in particular thanks to really the extraordinary and to some extent unexpected, really impressive progress that we made through the study of the background, cosmic background radiation, in a sense, the first, as I call it, in a kind of humoristic view, I call it the first selfie we have in the universe, meaning that it is, in a sense, a picture of a, that the universe took of itself. So this is the farthest radiation image we have from the universe. So thanks to it, we have a model which gives us the main ingredients constituting the entire universe. So here we have dark energy and dark matter, plus a minor component, but quite relevant for us, which are our baryons. Now, what is interesting is that these two models describing micro and macro cosmos are not living in two separate worlds. We could think that the two models describe the two extreme dimensions of the length that was present in the previous slide, namely the small scales and the largest possible scales. On the other hand, the two models can be put together and we can achieve really a kind of dynamical view of the interplay between the two standard models, going back to really the crucial phases which marked once forever the entire history of our universe. I'm referring to the very early stages of the universe. Now, if you apply here simultaneously our knowledge about particle physics, in particular the view of unification of the fundamental interactions, and the breaking of the symmetries related to these fundamental interactions. If you apply this together with our view of the provided by the cosmological model, you really obtain an impressive result concerning the origin and the first phases of the early universe. There are results which are incredible. The fact that we can compute today the abundance of light elements which are produced just in the very first seconds of the universe. And in fact, we find through observation that these computations, which make use of both standard models, give a very accurate result compared to our experimental tests. This is impressive because it means that really the two models are not just a simple description that we are providing of the two regimes of the, what I call the micro and macrocosmos, but indeed they correspond to a correct reproduction of the early stages of our universe. Now, an important point, as I said, of this view is this view of the unification of the fundamental interactions, and in fact also considering the standard model of particle physics, if we extrapolate it at higher energies, we see that the couplings, fundamental couplings, the gauge couplings characterizing this model have a tendency to to unify one. Okay. Now, you appreciate also that, as you can see, this unification is not completely achieved, which is an important signal, because it means that, in a sense, the standard model is a good approximation to a completely unified picture of a fundamental interaction, so yet some modification has to be performed standard model in order to achieve a more accurate unification of these interactions. And the possibility is that this modification is realized at an energy scale close to the electroweak energy scale, hence an energy scale which must be accessible to our accelerator machines. Now, the two standard models, the usual question which is put is, how standard are these standard models? Well, for both standard models, obviously the fact that we call them standard models means that they have passed a great series of tests with excellent results. There are here and there, there are a few possible clouds for these two models, in particular for the particle physics standard model. There is a well-known and long-standing issue related to the computation of the anomalous magnetic moment of the muon, and the comparison of this computation within the standard model with the experimental result. What is interesting is that this discrepancy, which is slightly less than 4 sigma, keeps standing on our way, or better, on the way of the standard model. And today we are going to have very soon the results of a new experiment which is performed on the magnetic moment of the muon, and we are going to see if such a result is going to be confirmed. There are other possible hints, but I would say that it is not, they do not represent, at least at the moment, a serious disease for the standard model of particle physics. The same can be said for the cosmological standard model. Also here, you know, the nature of dark matter described in the Landa CDM as a pure cold dark matter might present some problem for the description of the structure and distribution of matter in the galaxies, and also the origin of the large scale structures in the universe. Another interesting problem, or at least what could become a real problem, is the fact that if you measure the Hubble constant, so the velocity with which the universe is expanding, and you do it in two independent ways, one based on the cosmic background radiation, so going back in time just a few hundred thousand years after the Big Bang, or performing the measurement today, so a few billion years after the Big Bang, you find two values for the Hubble constant today, which differ. Now it is difficult to quantify the sigmas, maybe in this case, but in any case, differ in a rather significant way. So this we'll see the possible developments. And instead of this, as I told you, there are really remarkable successes related to the marriage of the two standard models. I repeat, the nucleosynthesis is, in my view, an extraordinary, and I'm not emphatic on this, I think it is really an extraordinary result of this happy marriage between the two standard models. Now, as I used to say, sometimes also the best marriage can become a bit boring if every day everything goes fine. So it is important that also in this happy marriage there is some points of friction, there is some pepper in this marriage of the two standard models. This paper is represented by issues which are denoted here as relevance for indications of new physics beyond the standard model, in particular of particle physics or both standard models. Dark matter, if you want also, you can add dark energy, although it is a different story, in my view. The cosmic asymmetry between matter and antimatter, inflation, an early inflationary epoch. So, if you want, we have in this moment observational facts telling us that the standard model of particle physics is not enough. So the question that is sometimes debated, is there a new physics beyond the standard model? I'm referring here to the standard model of particle physics. Well, in my view, is essentially it is a question which has an obvious answer. Yes, we know that there is a new physics beyond the standard model. This I'm ready to put as a statement, and not simply because it is a personal conviction, this is not to be so important, but because we have observational, and I insist on this qualification, these are not theoretical, theoretical observation, these are really experimental facts. We have the evidence of dark matter in terms of the presence of new particles, for instance, modifying gravity does not seem a possible way to account for what attribute to dark matter in terms of gravitational properties. The fact that neutrinos have a mass in the standard model of particle physics, neutrinos are strictly massless, at any order, in fact, they remain massless. The disappearance of antimatter, the fact that today we are here in a universe in which only matter is present and the primordial antimatter has disappeared. Again, if you use the standard model of particle physics, in spite of the fact that in the standard model of particle physics there are indeed the main ingredients to produce dynamically such an asymmetry, however, the standard model of particle physics fails quantitatively to produce enough matter-antimatter asymmetry. So all these are observational, I insist in particular with the young people present here, these are observational evidences that the new physics is not a dream of theorists or physicists in general who are want always to have something new to explore. Here it is a matter of nature, whether there is new physics beyond the standard model of particle physics. If You want the other two reasons I mentioned, primordial inflation and dark energy. In my view, for instance, I would not strongly support that they are really evidence for new physics beyond the particle standard model, because in that case, it could be that instead of new particles or new interactions, we should have a deeper and better comprehension of gravity at the quantum level. But this is another story. But for the other three main points, I insist that this is a direct evidence of such a kind of new physics which is present. Okay, these were some slides just for the students to remember, you know, to tell you of the, how physics is really something which can be unexpected and really give you some kind of emotion. I remember very well that around the year 2000, I was teaching at the time at CISA, and I was giving a course in astroparticle physics. And at that time, I had just given a lecture to the students where I had insisted, and I had put it as a statement. I said, look, we can discuss, and we don't know whether the universe is open, namely it's going to expand forever, or it is closed at some point, the expansion will end, and then we go maybe to some big crunch. However, there is one thing for which we are certain, that the velocity with which the universe is expanding can never increase. Why? Because when you throw a stone up to the sky, this stone can go forever, or at some point stops and comes down. However, we have never seen a stone that, after being thrown up, at some point decides to accelerate. Or maybe we can see it only in some cartoon, but not in reality. So I told the students, look, for sure, we know, but in fact, I told them, I remember very well, I said, in fact, we call this the acceleration parameter, because we know that it is an acceleration, but with a minus sign. The universe for sure accelerates. Well, then in the year 2000, around the year 2000, we had the surprise from observation that indeed the universe was a stone that at some point, after I think it is of the order of 10 billion years or so, this stone decides to accelerate. And today we have a modest, but still with a positive sign, acceleration of the universe. This is to tell you the emotion and the surprise that physics is. Okay, for the explanation, we go back as usual to the equation describing the evolution of the universe. You know very well the story that Einstein had not put this cosmological constant at the beginning, then he observed that the universe was expanding, so he put the cosmological constant to stop this expansion. Today we reintroduced this cosmological constant, but just to have an accelerated expansion to account for it. Obviously, introducing this cosmological constant with the convenient sign and value is not the solution of the problem of what is really the origin of this acceleration in the expansion of the universe. Okay, theoretically, you see we have several reasons to expect that there is a new physics beyond the standard model. We have not understood, whereby understood I mean we do not have a theory giving us predictions concerning the masses and the mixings of the three families of fermions. We don't have an answer to the problem why CP violation is not present in strong interactions. We observe this experimentally. We have very strong bounds, in particular on the electric dipole moment of the neutron, of the electron, but of the neutron, sorry. But we don't have a theory which gives us an explanation why a certain term which violates CP in a strong interaction should be absent or very, very small. Unification, I've already told you. And finally, there is this famous problem of the stability in a very different mass scales that we have present. This is the electroweak mass scale, so we are between 100 GeV and 1 TeV in energy scale, and the scale of grand unification, something of the order of 10 to 16 GeV, or the Planck scale, 10 to 19 GeV. Now, if you wanted to make a summary of what I said, is that we have these observational reasons for a new physics beyond the standard model. We have these theoretical reasons, but here I summarized the fact that we do not have an explanation for very small numbers which appear in the physics describing elementary particle physics. So the difference between electroweak and Planck scale, the difference between the energy that we measure of the vacuum through this expansion, accelerated expansion of the universe, and the electroweak scale. If you wanted to put it in very simple terms, as someone said, if you ask a student what is the value that the fields of the standard model take in the vacuum state. So a correct, brilliant student answers all the fields have zero value in the vacuum apart from one field which is called X boson, and its value in the vacuum, we know how much it is. The value of a field in the vacuum is 100. So, second question, then what is the energy which is present in the vacuum? You then say, I've just answered, the energy in the vacuum is the energy brought about by the energy of the Higgs boson in the vacuum, so it is of the order of 100 GeV. So you go and you measure it through the expansion of the universe, and you find that you are many, many orders of magnitude, is 10 to minus 14 has to take to be for power, and you get many orders of magnitude of difference between the two answers. And notice that the student passes his exam because he gave the correct answer. The problem is that we don't know what is the correct answer to what nature is asking us, or at least what we think that nature is asking us. Okay, now, once we are convinced that there are these new reasons to go beyond the standard model, next question is, at which scale do we expect this new physics or these different forms of new physics? We could have also different kinds of new physics to account for these different problems. At which energy scale are they present, these sources of new physics? Now, this is not an academic question. This is a very concrete question. You know, 10 days ago, 600 physicists met in Granada for what is called the town meeting. A town meeting is a kind of community meeting of to discuss about the future of particle physics, what is called the European strategy for particle physics. Every 5-6 years, the community of particle physicists in Europe gathers together to discuss the strategic lines. The question was, yes, if I am to decide a strategy, I must know the objective that I want to reach through this strategy. So, objective is very well defined. I want to find the new physics beyond the standard. Good. Are you sure, first of all, that this new physics exists? Answer, yes, I am sure, and I told you why I answer, yes, I am sure. Second question, as usual, when you start a trip, first you ask, but are you sure that the town we are heading to is a town that exists? Says, yes, the town exists. Okay, second question is, tell me the coordinates of this town, if you want that I go there. Now, unfortunately, we know that this island of new physics exists, but we don't know where it is, at which energy scale, and also which shape it has. What is the new physics? Are they new particles, new interactions? Which kind of new particles? And it was very interesting to see a community of 600 particle physicists debating about the roads to take for this challenging and fascinating. If you think a moment, this is really complete research into the unknown, the roads to approach this new physics. Obviously, in a moment when you don't know where to go, you must keep an open attitude. You see, before we started LHC, or so the previous machines to LHC, we knew that we had in front of us a difficult kind of bending road, not an easy road. We had to discover new particles, in particular the Higgs boson. However, this was a road difficult to go through, where, however, we knew the milestones, the last stops in this road. Now, for the new road, you see, we don't For instance, in the past, if you wanted to go to the 50s of the past century, we had a theory like the Fermi theory. This theory, we knew that to be consistent, there had to be new physics at the well-defined scale, which was a scale corresponding to something like TV of energy. So the question, for instance, that Fermi asked was, can I build an accelerator where I can reach the TV scale? Because there I am sure that this theory, that today we call Fermi's theory, is going to predict the existence of new physics. Incidentally, he thought that the accelerator had to be an accelerator having the diameter of the Earth. Thanks to some progress in technology, we succeeded to reduce the dimension of this accelerator. But what is important here is the fact that I knew which energy to target. You know, in this case, if you repeat the same exercise for the standard model, so taking for instance the graviton scattering, and you conclude that there must be new physics below the Planck scale. But this was already present in the previous slides without doing any computation. So the conclusion is that in this moment, instead of this difficult but drawn road, we have in front of us a kind of ocean to explore. So a possible a possibility to have indication is to consider that issue that I defined as the gauge hierarchy problem, namely the fact that we want to protect the mass of the Higgs boson and hence the scale of the electric weak breaking, preventing it from jumping to a very large scale. Now, no matter which kind of new symmetries or new kinds of structure you impose, if you want to have a kind of explanation of this hierarchy, then ensuring what technically we call a naturalness of a theory, in that case, you are going to predict the existence of some new physics at the electroweak scale. The other possibility is to go through a kind of unnatural road, and in that case, there is no particular reason to expect precisely new physics at the electroweak scale. Now, I leave it to you in particular again, to the young people here, a few slides where I make some considerations about this. Approaches. One possible approach, which I think is in this moment extremely interesting, and in particular for a young person, should be really quite an attractive possibility, is to take the so-called astroparticle approach, where you try to combine astrophysics, cosmology, and particle physics together, studying, for instance, what we call multi-messenger physics, so different manifestations of the highest energy regions in the universe through emission of cosmic rays, gammas, neutrinos, gravitational waves, studying neutrino physics, or, as I said, issues like dark matter and dark energy. For dark matter, I leave to you a few slides to tell the situation we have at the moment. If you want just a summary of this, and I repeat, I think there can be interesting indications for for those who are not expert through these slides of the present situation, but let me summarize here saying that the possibility that there are new particles which are called WIMP, namely particles of a mass of the order of the electroweak scale, 100 GeV or a few hundred GeV, and with weak couplings, which is indeed and remains a nice possibility, because it turns out that the abundance of this particle is in the right ballpark to explain the for count better for the dark matter presence. Well, today, given the fact that the searches that we have made with an impressive precision, you know, we reached something that for me as a theorist is almost inconceivable. You know, these numbers, something like 10 to minus 10 picobarn. So, you know, testing cross sections at the level of 10 to minus 10 picobarn without finding any trace whatsoever of the presence of these WIMP particles.
And obviously,
with a possible important effect, one exception, which is prompting us, in fact, in the direction of exploring even better not only the possibility of traditional WIMPs, which are excluded in fact for the interpretation of this exception, but for possible alternative routes to WIMPs. And in fact this is important because nowadays there is more and more interest on a different approach in which we do not think of dark matter as a single particle inside the context of a standard model, for instance, like in the supersymmetric construction. Rather, we think that there could be an entire dark sector related to the presence of dark matter, and there should be some communication between these two sectors, the sector of the standard model of particle physics and this new dark sector through some portal. And really an impressive number of studies, in particular leading also possible phenomenological consequences is now going on. I conclude this talk summarizing a bit the three approaches which were also emphasized in this town meeting that I referred to, namely the astroparticle line, the traditional energy frontier, namely the possibility of building a new future machines in which we can increase the possible energy and so the possibility of producing new particles, and the so-called intensity frontier. And I conclude with this intensity frontier, again, in particular for young students here. You know, there is something which is marvelous about quantum physics, namely there is a way to explore reality not through the production of new particles, but through the presence of these new particles in modifying processes that we can measure. So, for instance, you can have a process, a very low energy process. Suppose that I have a machine at 5, 10 GeV of mass. Can I
see with 10 GeV mass a particle which is more than 100 GeV. Any reasonable person would say, no, it is impossible. If you have 10 GeV at the disposal, you can never see produce something which is 100 GeV, which is 10 times larger. Well, thanks to quantum physics, it is possible to have such a heavy particle, for instance, in this case, a top quark, which interferes through a virtual effect with the physics at five GeV, producing sizable results. So I can perform very detailed studies remaining, for instance, at the electroweak scale, yet I can explore the presence of much heavier particles through this precision physics. And this is what is done, for instance, in this anomalous magnetic moment of a muon, which is a very low energy experiment. In fact, you are measuring the coupling of a muon with a photon. However, in these loops that are drawing here, these are referred to QED loops, but then you have electroweak contribution, then you have hadronic contribution, etc. Well, the net result is that at the end, when you compare your theoretical computations with the standard model, you find a discrepancy which goes from 3.5 to 4 sigma, so a significant discrepancy. Maybe this can be a possible field. What is important is that if G minus 2 is confirmed, then the new physics responsible for this anomalous magnetic moment of the muon, this new physics has to be at the TV scale, or else it would not produce a sizable effect on the magnetic moment of the muon. So this would be a confirmation that this new physics is not far from us, but close to the electroweak scale. Okay, so I think it is time to conclude. Those of you who are interested on this subject, personally, as you hear from my voice, fascinates me about the possibility of linking the anomalous magnetic moment of the muon for a new physics at the electroweak scale, with the dark matter problem, which is again a possible hint for your physical electroweak scale, those who are interested and would ask, is there a possible connection between the two issues? I invite them to go through these slides. They are not going to find an answer to this question. I would have already published this, obviously. But at least you can find some papers which try to approach this issue. Okay, so let me just conclude with a little story for again addressing the young people here. You know, one day we are almost at the end of the 19th century, there is a very brilliant, here in Germany, there is a very brilliant student that had the highest possible marks in the high school, who is uncertain about the studies to take at the university. He has a passion for science, in particular for physics, but at the same time, he has also a great enthusiasm for music. So, should I become a physicist or a pianist? This guy was very certain. So, one day he said, okay, let's do the following. I go to speak with famous professor of the university was in Berlin. So he goes to this famous professor of physics at the university. He says, look, I would like to decide, I'm very interested in physics, would you advise me to take physics? Well, the professor says, ah, I see that you are a very brilliant student, so we would be very glad if you come to do physics. I must warn you that, you know, the great problems in physics have been solved by now. We have for mechanics, we have the Newtonian theory. For electromagnetism, we have the Maxwell laws. So, you know, we have a description, we have dynamics, etc. We have a description of a fundamental laws of physics, but don't worry. We can find some problems. There are many applications that we can study, etc., etc. But I just wanted to warn you, since you are a very, very brilliant student, that unfortunately the fundamental issues have been clarified, and by now our physics is complete. The student, this bright young student, thinks for some time. He says that at some point he was almost convinced to go to piano career, but finally he took physics. And well, the conclusion is that the name of this student is Max Planck. And so this, I think, is a clear message for the young people today of what can expect from physics.
Thank you very much. It is time for two short questions or comments. I will say the comment at some point.
Yeah,
sure. No, but share this with us.
Should I?
Yeah, sure.
So the point was that there is an experiment actually in this university, which is the Dama Libre experiment. And the Dama Libre experiment finds a signal modulated with the right time for the occurrence of the transition to the maximum as expected from the motion of the Earth around the Sun. The point is that other experiments with other types of materials find zero results. So the question is whether there is a selective interaction doing the job there or not?
No, this, as Augusto is reminding us, this is a very, very important, indication we have. In fact, it is important that it comes from Kiev. People, they are not only in this university, but in any case, the central nucleus of this thesis is here. This indication, together with the absence of positive signals from other experiments, my view put the question whether we could envisage a kind of dark matter which is not in the form, as I described to you, of a new particle having a weak interaction and in the range between few GeV up to few hundred GeV, so what we call a weakly interacting massive particle wind. But we could, for instance, think of different kinds of particles, maybe related to the dark sector that I was mentioning, and this experiment could provide us some possible hint to go in two directions which are not explored by other experiments. It is important that these other experiments are not looking to the modulation as the Dama Libra experiment. They are done with different materials, so the issue remains open. Although I must say that it is not easy to find a form of dark matter that at the same time accounts for both the Dama Libra results on one hand and all the negative results coming from all the other searches.
There is another question by Nazario.
You can reply from the mic.
Just want to know your private opinion. I mean, the fact is that the standard model actually is a peculiar. We are all convinced that there is physics beyond, and one can play the game Fermi plays, but in fact, the standard model is renormalizable. Even though it is an effective theory, it doesn't suggest a scale. So I think that the particle physics community at some point has to face this fact. This fact.
For sure. This I agree. It's not an effective theory in the sense that being a normalizable theory can live by itself. But you know, it is an effective theory in our view, but as I said, we are convinced, in particular by these observational reasons, that there must be a new physics beyond the standard model. And if this new physics beyond the standard model is at energies higher than the typical scale of the standard model, then we can think of the standard model as a kind of low energy approximation of this more fundamental theory. Now, what is important, which is a bit related to your question, is that if you think a moment, our approach is always to consider in physics a kind of effective theories at any scale. For instance, if you have a problem, an atomic physics problem, to solve an atomic physics problem, you don't go to study a QCD book. Why? Because you say I am at a very different scale, and so I consider that my knowledge at the atomic scale is related to atomic physics without dealing with all the details of the physics at a very different scale, which can be the quantum physics, the same as do for nuclear physics, for molecular physics, so on. So physics is done step by step, considering at any energy scale as a kind of effective theory describing the physics at that scale. Now, if you take this approach that I defined unnatural to the gauge hierarchy, it would be the first time in physics where to describe physics at 100 GV, you must enter into detail, into a detailed description about a physics which is 16 orders of magnitude above. It would be like saying I have an atomic physics problem, then I have to know quite in detail the quark dynamics to answer this atomic physics problem. So you see, the effective theory approach is really the successful way we have to deal with our ignorance at different and larger scales. And this we applied systematically every time in physics. It could be that with a standard model, the story changes. The physics of a standard model is entirely determined by a a precise knowledge of parameters which are 16 orders of magnitude above. So this is a possibility, an interesting possibility. However, what I'm saying is that it would be a completely new framework in particle physics.
Okay, let's thank again the speaker. Guest of honor of this meeting, Pierluigi Nilo, the winner of the prize, the Jassen Stannett Prize. We will talk about isospin breaking effects and nucleon electric dipole moment in holographic QCD.
Okay, thank you. Hi, everyone. Let me say a few words in Italian before I start. So, vi ringrazio tutti per essere qui. Volevo ringraziare Gianfranco e tutta la commissione per l'onore di questo premio e anche tutta la macchina organizzativa che c'è dietro questo evento. Non conosco i nomi, però ringrazio tutti. E volevo ringraziare Francesco, che è il mio relatore di tesi, che è stata appunto una colonna portante della mia preparazione universitaria. E volevo ringraziare i miei genitori che sono qui presenti perché mi supportano e mi sopportano ovunque sia. E infine volevo ringraziare tutti gli studenti, gli insegnanti e i genitori che si battono ogni giorno più o meno silenziosamente per un'istruzione pubblica di qualità in questo paese. Grazie. Ok. Yeah, no. So my master thesis work has been defended in 2017, so I hope to remember what I did 2 years ago. So the title is Isospin Breaking Effects and Nuclear Electric Dipole Moment in Holographic QCD. Okay. So first of all, I will introduce briefly what are the non-perturbative aspects of QCD, and I will discuss what is holography, which is the instrument that we use to describe in particular the Witten-Sakashvili-Moto model. Then I will discuss the results of the thesis, in particular the vacuum properties and the computation of the nucleon electric dipole moment. Okay, as you all know, QCD is the theory of the strong interaction, so it's a SUN gauge theory which is coupled to NF fundamental fermions. So this is the Lagrangian of QCD. The first part contains the mediators of the strong force, which are the gluons. And the second part contains matters, which are the quarks, which are in the fundamental representation of the gauge group. It is known from RG flow that the coupling constant of the theory runs with the energy of the system, and in particular at high energy, the coupling constant is very small, much smaller than one. And so we are in the so-called perturbative regime of the theory. So we can use the usual machinery of Feynman diagrams and all. But at low energy, the coupling constant is order one, so we are in the so-called non-perturbative regime, so new tools must be applied to study this regime. One of the most important aspects of non-perturbative physics of QCD is the spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry. This happens if the mass of the quark is zero, so we have chiral symmetry in the ultraviolet theory, and this is believed to be spontaneously broken through the diagonal subgroup. So, the most important properties of QCD are confinement and mass gap. So, what is confinement? Confinement is the statement that all the asymptotic states of the theory are singlets of the gauge group. So, we cannot observe the quarks and the gluons, but we can only observe the bound states, which are the mesons, the baryons, and the gluons. The property of mass gap is the property that the lightest asymptotic state of the theory has a non-zero mass. This is true in QCD only if the mass of the quark is different from zero, because otherwise from Goldstone theorem you know that there are some Goldstone bosons due to chiral symmetry breaking. So if we want to investigate the dynamics of bound states, then we have to use a non-perturbative approach for what I said before. So what we were interested in this thesis was to analyze the topological property of QCD. These are due to a so-called theta term, which is present in the theory, which is this term here, so theta, the Levi-Civita tensor in four dimensions, trace of the product of the two fixed length. So this is a topological term because it can be shown that it's a total derivative, so it depends only on boundary condition of the theory. then it's really an angle theta because it's invariant under 2π rotation. The physics of the system is invariant if I do a 2π shift of theta. And then if we want to study topological properties of QCD, we have really to study the massive theory, because it can be shown if only one quark is massless, then the theta dependence cancels away. Why we focus on theta term? Because this has been recalled before, the theta term is even under charge conjugation, but is odd under parity and tangent inversa. So since CPT symmetry is believed to be a symmetry of any quantum field theory, so if theta is different from zero, then CP symmetry is explicitly broken in QCD. So one may ask, okay, nice, but what is the value of theta in nature? So to estimate theta, we have to consider some observables that is sensible to CP violation. And these observables are permanent electric dipole moments of baryons and nuclei. So let me do a classical reasoning to explain why this is the case. So if you consider an object, so the electric dipole moment can be proportional only to the spin of this object, which is the only vector available in the rest frame, and there is a function d which depends on the charge distribution. So under parity, since the spin epsilon vector doesn't change sign, but under charge conjugation, the dipole changes sign because it depends on the charge structure of the nucleon. So globally under CP, d is odd. Whereas if we consider an external electric field, E, this is odd, both under P and under C. So it is CP even. So the interaction energy of an electric dipole moment with an external electric field is CP odd. Oh, yeah, no, I have it, but I'm not using it.
I can use it because the question is very difficult.
Okay, see. Yeah, so this is the electric dipole, which is proportional to the spin, and so the dipole under parity is even because it behaves like a pseudo vector, and the charge conjugation is odd because this function d depends on the charge distribution of the system. So under the product CP, this is an odd quantity. Whereas an external electric field is even both under CP because it's odd both under parity and under charge conjugation. So globally, if you consider the interaction energy of an electric dipole moment with an external magnetic electric field, this is a CP odd object. So if we measure an electric dipole moment of a baryon or a nuclei, this means that the underlying ultraviolet theory, which is QCD, is breaking CP. And so this can help to give an estimate of the value of theta in nature. Okay, so this has been done. So experimentally, the neutron electric dipole moment has been measured, and it's very close to zero, it's 3 times 10 to the minus 26 in a suitable unit. And the theoretical estimate is that this object is proportional to theta times 10 to the minus 16 in the same unit. So if we compare these two values, we see that theta is much smaller to 10 to the minus 10, and this is the so-called strong CP problem. So why a constant of nature is so small? And there are many possible solutions. The most famous one is the existence of axions, but I'm not going to comment here about the solution of this strong CP problem, just assuming that QCD has a theta parameter and going to try to understand what is the vacuum structure of the theory according to theta. So now maybe the objective of the thesis are more clear. So first of all, we wanted to compute the theta dependence of vacuum properties, in particular vacuum energy density, topological susceptibility, and the spectrum of light mesons. And secondly, we wanted to compute numerically the nucleon electric dipole moments, so the nucleon is both a proton or a neutron. For what I said before, non-perturbative techniques are needed in order to pursue this objective. Okay, what are the available non-perturbative techniques in QCD? So we have lattice QCD, which is a simulation of the real theory, but it's very difficult to investigate topological properties. This is due to the so-called sign problem, which is a technical problem on the lattice. Then we have the Carrier-Lagrangian approach, which is an effective field theory, so it's able to capture the symmetries of the theory in the infrared, but still is a phenomenological approach in which, if you want to add more terms and discuss more structure, it's very difficult to, should be put by hand, all that we want to describe. And then there is an old idea by Toft, which is the Lagrangian expansion. So in this expansion, some properties can be proven analytically, also it allows a non-relativistic description of baryons, because the mass of the baryon scales with n, so it's very heavy, so it's a non-relativistic object. But still, of course, if we want to compare with real QCD, we have to extrapolate large n result down to n equal to 3. So for us, one third is basically zero. Okay, here we use a complementary approach, which is gauge gravity duality or holography. So it's not better or worse, it's just a different approach. So what is holography? Holography is a correspondence between a quantum field theory in the dimension and quantum gravity theory in at least one dimension more. So we can suppose to have a five-dimensional space-time where some quantum theory of gravity lives there. And on the boundary of this space-time, there is a flat Lorentzian space-time where there is some quantum field theory. And the statement of holography is that the two descriptions are equivalent. So, nice, but we don't want to transform a difficult problem in a more difficult problem. So, the fact that holography is useful is due, apart from theoretical reasons, is due to the fact that it acts like a strong, weak duality. So, in the sense that if we take the quantum field theory and we do the limit where the theory is strongly coupled with a lot of degrees of freedom, then the quantum theory of gravity, how complicated it may be, becomes classical gravity, so general relativity coupled to some dynamical fields. So, the fact that holography acts as a duality allows to use the equation of motion from gravity dynamics to describe non-perturbative phenomena in field theory, and this is what we are going to do now. More precisely, to some operator in quantum field theory, you associate some dynamical field in gravity, and the formula that we're going to use is that the partition function of the quantum field theory, which if you know everything about the QFT, is given by the exponentiation of the gravity action put on shell on the solution of the equation of motion with some boundary condition. A very important aspect is that a global symmetry in quantum field theory, which is associated to a Noether current J, is associated to a gauge symmetry in gravity, and this will come back in our what we'll discuss. So from now we can already imagine what will be the holographic dual of QCD. So it will be a five-dimensional theory on a curved space-time where the global symmetry of QCD, which is a UNF, will be a gauge symmetry on the gravity side. Okay, so after this introduction, I will discuss what is the model that we used. We proceed in two steps. First of all, we give the dual of Young-Mills, so the pure blue theory, and then on top of it, we add fermions. So the Young-Mills is, there is some string theory set up that I'm not going to comment a lot, but basically it's a D4 brains wrapped on a circle. And on the QFT side, you have a SUN gauge theory in four dimension, which is Young-Mills theory, but coupled to some Kaluza-Klein massive fields, and the coupling between this tower of fields and the gauge sector is given by some constant lambda. In the limit in which lambda and the number of color is much greater than one, on the gravity side we have a curved space-time with some metric that I wrote here schematically, which has a topology of the cigar. A cigar which is regular at the tip, and this allows to prove on the gravity side some of the properties I was talking at the beginning, which are only believed to be true but are not proven in actual QCD, and these properties are confinement and the existence of a mass gap. So even if you are not describing actual Young-Mills, but a Young-Mills-like theory, it's very nice that we are able to prove some of the properties that we are struggling with in ordinary QCD. So on top of this model, we add flavors. This has been done by Sakai Sugimoto in 2004. They consider it in the string theory perspective, adding D8 and anti-D8 brains on the background of Witten, in the probe approximation, so the background is still the same. So on the QFT side, we have the Witten model and massless quarks. On the gravity side, we have what we expect, so a five-dimensional gauge theory with gauge group UF on some curved background. This is the action, it's not very illuminating, but the fact is that it's an action where all the terms are fixed in terms of the string theory embedding, so it's a top-down approach, and then it's the gauge symmetry, it is what was the global symmetry on the QFT, which is UNF. Just a technical remark, current symmetry breaking is geometrically realized in this setup, so this is very nice from the theoretical point of view, mainly the fact that these D8 and anti-D8 brains, which are separated in the ultraviolet, join at the tip of the cigar. So this, what does this Lagrangian, this action describes? This action describes Gibbs invariant objects, so the mesons and the variants. So mesons are interpreted as the fluctuation of the Gibbs field, and this allows to describe not only the pions, but also the eta prime meson, and all the tower of resonances of massive vector and axial mesons of QCD. Whereas the baryons are interpreted as instanton configuration for the Gibbs field. And in particular, the instanton charge is identified with the baryon number on the QFT side. So what we want to do is to discuss topological properties. So we have to add two terms, a theta term, but the theta term is not enough, because we have to add also mass terms in order for the theory to have non-trivial topological properties. So to add the theta term, this has been done by Witten in 98, simply switching on a one form in the Witten background, such that the integral of this form under the circle where the D4 are compactified can be identified as a theta term. And this leads to the to adding some S theta to the action. And the mass term, we follow the proposal by Aroni and Kutazov from some computation of long open strings stretching from the D8 to the anti-D8. So in this context, the mass term cannot be local, because left and right components of the fermion leaves one on the D8, one on the anti-D8. So you need like a non-local object, like a Wilson line, to connect the two. So here C is a constant which is known in terms of the ultramarine parameter of string theory, and M is the mass matrix of the theory. Okay, this is also the ground. What we did was to focus on the case where we have light quarks, so only two quarks. So the mass matrix is M up and down, and we allow for equilibrating effect. So basically, we take the up and the down masses to be different. So epsilon is the parameter which parameterizes the deviation from the isospin preserving case. And if we take epsilon different from zero, so we are considering the isospin symmetry equilibrating. So the procedure that we followed in the case was the following. First of all, we have to identify the vacuum of the quantum theory, and the vacuum of the theory is the solution we're talking after. Gravity, also nothing at the gravity, so F equals to zero. But if we minimize the potential, given by the fact that we put some mass and theta term in the action, we get some non-trivial profile of the Gibbs field, still with F equals to zero. And once we have the minimum of the potential, we put back on the action, the gravitational action, we compute it on shell, we exponentiate it, and from the log, we get the energy of the quantum field. So this has been done in the physics. And the result is the following. So the vacuum energy density is this, expressing the term of C, the constant, M, which is the mean value of the quark masses, and this is the theta dependent and the epsilon dependent. So this agrees with the expectation from quantum field theory. This is an even and periodic function in theta. The absolute minimum is at theta equal to zero, which, by the way, explains why action solves the quantum field problem, because action is basically a dynamical theta. With this potential that relaxes to zero, so the strong city problem goes away. And it is nice that if you recall the definition of epsilon, epsilon is equal to plus or minus one if only one of the two quarks is massless. If we put epsilon equal one, then you get there is no theta dependence anymore. Okay, then we computed the topological susceptibility of the theory, which is simply the second derivative of this object, and this is nothing but, apart from a constant, the reduced mass of the two quarks. This again is nice, because if one is massless, then nothing topological happens. Finally, for the vacuum, we computed the spectrum of pions and the eta prime mesons. So we have two flavors now, so there are three pions and one eta prime singlet. And we did the computation for both theta and epsilon different from zero, but here I reported as a simple case. So this gives only the topological dependence, so we have no isospin breaking effects, but topological effects. So we see that the charged pion and the neutral pion and the theta correction is just a cosine on top of this parameter, the same for the eta prime measure. This is the Witten-Bernicano contribution applied to the mass of the eta prime. And then in the other case, if you consider only two spin breaking effects, no theta term, what you are able to get is an expression for the mass difference between the charge pile and the neutral pile, which is different from zero, so it's proportional to epsilon squared.
Proportional to epsilon square is expected because you know that you exchange up and down, epsilon changes sign, but the internal composition of the path does not change, and so it should be a little function of epsilon. first part, where we study topological properties of the vacuum. Then we come to the second part of the thesis, which is the study of the baryons and the nuclear electric dipole moment to give an estimate of theta. So, what are the baryons? The baryons are interpreted as instanton solution of the gauge field, of the gauge theory in five dimensions. In particular, this instanton is not an ordinary instanton which lives in x1, x2, x3 and time, but lives in x1, x2, x3 and the holographic direction. So time is left over from this.
What do you call it? Sorry.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, this, because this is already Euclidean space. So, for nf equal to 2, these people have computed what is the unperturbed instanton solution, so without theta and without the Fleber mass, so just the action as zero of the model. And this instanton, as always, is parameterized by some moduli. These moduli are the finite radius rho, the position of the center of mass in the holographic direction, z, and three parameters of SU2 rotation. So now we take the solution and we put it back on the action. What we get is a function of time, which is the only coordinate which we don't integrate on. And this function of time is interpreted as the Hamiltonian of the system, where the parameter rho, z, and a, which characterize the solution, becomes operator in a non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So as I said before, quantum mechanics is okay now because the baryons is very heavy, because his mass can be shown to be proportional to the number of color, which is much greater than one. So at this point we have the Hamiltonian for the unperturbed baryon, and the eigenvectors of this Hamiltonian are clearly interpreted as some baryon. These baryons are some quantum numbers, isospin and spin. So now what we want to do is to perturb the baryon solution with the mass. This is the original part of our work. So, first of all, we observe that if you add S theta and S mass, the baryon Hamiltonian get corrected only for order theta whole square, not order theta, or linear order in theta. And since we want to just focus on linear order in theta, for us, the perturbed baryon will be the same as the unperturbed baryon state. Now, it's very easy to identify nucleon states. We just put that the isospin and spin are 1/2. And then for the projection of isospin, this distinguishes the proton from the neutron. So we have the baryon state for, of the full theory with the topology and with the mass for the flavors. Then we need to perturb the solution, the instanton. So we did a computation in perturbation theory around an instanton configuration to find what is the profile of the gauge field which corrects the instanton solution known of in the unperturbed case. So we did this, and then we get some formula, which I'm not showing because it's not very illuminating. But the fact is that if you have the solution for the gauge profile, what you can do is remember the relation between the global symmetry in QFT and the gauge symmetry in gravity, is that you can compute the global current associated to U2 or SU2 of isospin. So from the solution of the equation of motion, we compute the vector current. From the vector current, you have the electric charge, because the electric charge is just the third projection of isospin plus 1/2 of the baryon number. So, perturb the solution, compute it, compute JV, compute the electromagnetic current. From this, the time component is the electric charge. So the electric dipole moment is the integral over all space, just pure space, position vector times rho, the electric charge distribution. And this is an operator in quantum mechanics now, because this object depends on the parameter of the instanton, and this should be computed on the nucleon state. So we did this computation as well, and what we get is that our object, so the nucleon electric dipole moment, is proportional to this combination, to the spin of the nucleon, which is what we expected from pure, simple arguments. And isospin breaking effects comes again in the fact that this proportionality is actually proportionality to linearity in theta and m star, so the reduced mass of the two quarks. And finally, this depends on the third projection of the isospin. So proton and a neutron have opposite electric dipole moment. But still, isospin breaking is not enough to violate this sum rule. So if you want to compute, for instance, the deuteron electric dipole moment, which is the simplest bound state between neutron and proton, you have to go beyond this perturbation theory. Then we had fun in comparing this with the true life. So we fitted the meson physics, so we took the mass of the pion decay constant, and the mass of a vector meson. This is standard in the holographic literature. And we put arbitrarily nc equal to 3. So we get this number for the fit. And the final result is in agreement with previous estimate in the literature, so it is 0.7 10 to the minus 16 theta electron charge times centimeter, which is in agreement with the previous estimate in the literature. And recall that this result is reliable still at first order in theta, m, and unfortunately 1 over m. Okay, so let me summarize. So what we did in the thesis work, we extended the Witten-Sakai-Sugimoto model in the complicated case where theta is different from zero, and we have also isospin breaking effects. We computed vacuum properties, so vacuum energy density, topological susceptibility, and meson masses. Then we gave a numerical estimate of the nuclear electric dipole moments, and all these using holography. As I said before, holography is a complementary approach, so it has some advantages and some disadvantages. In particular, we are able to reproduce the low energy features of QCD with a top-down approach. It was simple to introduce topological mass term, at least to first order. I mean, it was simple because Witten taught us how to do it, so we just followed him. And it allows for a non-relativistic description of baryons again. Still, the problem is when you compare to real physics, because you have to extrapolate to nc equal to 3. And don't forget that it's not pure means because there are some Kaluza-Klein modes. But the fact that so many properties can be proven analytically, it's make us hope that some insight we have on these properties. Okay, let me just conclude 1 minute with the most important isospin breaking effect is the strong force-induced neutron-proton mass difference. And this we did actually with Francesco after the thesis.
I just you should say Francesco Migliazzi, because yeah, there's another Francesco.
No, Francesco Bigazzi, which is there. And so the tools developed in the thesis allow to compute the strong force contribution to the neutron-proton mass difference. So we put theta equal to zero. We are just interested in isospin breaking effects. And this is, as you know, is a crucial quantity in nature because the sign of this, so the fact that it's positive, means that the proton is a stable particle, which is very important. And also the magnitude of this difference is very important for the timeline of how fast stars, how fast the nuclear fusion in the stars happen. So what we realize is that if you put epsilon different from zero, then the baryon Hamiltonian contains a term which is proportional to epsilon, and then the tensor product between the isospin operator and identity on the spin space. So this means that once you compute the expectation value of this guy on the neutron and the proton, you get a sign difference due to this guy. And so you get that the globally, this difference is proportional to the difference between the down and the up quark, as you may expect. But the nice fact that we are able to produce an analytic formula for this, which is quite nice, and which is complicated but not that much. And fortunately, we got the correct sign for this difference. Maybe we did an even number of errors, but it's okay. Then we had fun in computing this for real life. And so if you compute the difference, you get 5.2 MeV, which is 3 times 2 MeV, which is the strong force contribution, still 1 over 3 error, so we're happy. But the nice thing is that if you compute the adimensional quantity, which is the difference divided by the mean value of the mass, you get 0.25% to be compared to 0.27 from the lattice. You cannot compare this with true physics because you don't know, you cannot measure only the strong force contribution, you have to measure both. And okay, so this was a nice follow-up of our work. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this beautiful presentation of a very nice piece of work, and I believe there are many questions that someone will ask, otherwise I will go on asking myself.
So please ask.
Giancarlo, please.
Just a curiosity. class results for the energy as a function of theta.
Yes.
Are you getting same results that you get with the chiral Lagrangian?
Yeah, of course, if you... are you
getting something more, something better, something consistent? How do you compare?
So, the way you compare is just you take the value of C and M that can be compared to the chiral Lagrangian coefficients. The fact is that here everything is fixed from the top-down approach. So, of course, the final result, we are happy that is consistent with chiral Lagrangian expectation. It cannot be different if you want, if you analyze only the vacuum and not the excitations. But this is, I mean, the nice thing is the top-down. So, is the coefficient that is matters, not the structure is known, of course.
But then what is C?
So C is some function of lambda, so the Toft coupling.
So, okay.
So C, it's just a constant lambda cube n over pi something.
Okay.
So the parameter is really comes from the string theory embedding of the thing.
Nazario has a question.
From a first principle calculation, the fact that the neutron minus proton mass difference comes positive comes from a very subtle balance between the pure QCD contribution and the QAD contribution.
Yeah,
so I wanted you to comment about that, if the QAD contribution is in some way included. Otherwise, the sign should be
negative. Okay, so here is just the strong force contribution. So if you go to the lattice result, the lattice result tells this number is 2 MeV, and the electromagnetic contribution is minus 0.7. Of course, the electromagnetic contribution will make the neutron lighter than the proton because it's uncharged. This is only the strong force contribution. So not only should be positive, it should be greater than the electromagnetic contribution in absolute value. And this happens for this model because other people have computed the electromagnetic contribution, which is actually smaller in absolute value than this. But this is just the strong force. There is nothing that we inside here that tells about electromagnetic interaction. I mean, there is no E in this formula.
Other questions or comments? Okay. Let's thank again
sent a letter, so I would like to read it for Sydney. It's in Italian. Cari amici e colleghi di Yassin, anche se molto addolorata per la sua inaspettata e prematura scomparsa, per me e per il nostro figlio Dennis, che in quel momento doveva iniziare la sua prima sessione estiva del corso di laurea in fisica, è stato un duro colpo. Sono contenta di aver avuto a fianco una persona così eccezionale, sia dal lato intellettuale che umano come Yassin. Per lui non c'era nulla di scontato. Ogni cosa si doveva controllare e ricontrollare per essere certi che fosse la soluzione giusta. L'approccio veniva usato sia per i calcoli scientifici che per il rumore del motore dell'auto, ma anche per la lingua della tastiera del computer da ordinare per il collega sul MEPA. Per chi non sapesse, il MEPA era il sistema della pubblica amministrazione. È stato uno dei suoi più grandi pregi e difetti nello stesso tempo. Un approccio che deve essere applicato da tutti coloro che lavorano nel duro e spesso non apprezzato ambito della ricerca scientifica. Sono veramente felice che in sua memoria sia stato istituito il premio Yassin Stanner per la miglior tesi magistrale nell'ambito della fisica teorica per premiare e stimolare i giovani ricercatori che sono all'inizio di questo duro lavoro. Lavoro che spesso porta a frustrazioni perché i calcoli non sempre vengono come vorremmo, ma anche a soddisfazioni quando si riesce ad intuire l'idea giusta, fare i calcoli e pubblicarli prima degli altri. Yassin confidava moltissimo nelle capacità e nelle creatività dei giovani, accusava sempre la gerontocrazia sia nella vita sociale e politica che in quella scientifica. Era dell'opinione che ai giovani si devono dare più opportunità, anche decisionali, perché è loro il futuro e sapranno meglio come gestirlo. Conoscendo questo suo spirito, penso che l'idea di istituire in sua memoria un premio proprio per i più giovani nel suo ambito sia la soluzione che gli farebbe, sia una soluzione che gli farebbe veramente piacere. Ringrazio tutti i membri della commissione che, malgrado tutti gli impegni, hanno dedicato una parte del loro prezioso tempo per la selezione della migliore tesi di fisica teorica dell'anno 2017. Segue la lista di nomi che abbiamo già detto prima. Uno speciale ringraziamento ai suoi colleghi dell'Università di Tor Vergata e NFN, che sono stati gli ideatori e gli organizzatori di questo bellissimo premio. Infine vorrei scusarmi con tutti voi per la mia assenza per questa bellissima cerimonia e spero veramente che la prossima volta avremo la possibilità di partecipare. So now we can go on with the award ceremony. So on behalf of the panel of the committee of the University of Tor Vergata and of the INFN, Istituto Nazionale Fisica Nucleare, I would like to express you my warmest congratulations for the Yassin Stanet Prize. And the presentation will be done by Anna Di Ciaccio and Lucio Cerrito.